All right, welcome back everyone to yet another video. And in today's video, I wanted to cover my earnings expectations for Robinhood. So today it is the 29th of July, a Tuesday. Robinhood reports tomorrow on Wednesday. So I thought, why not take you through some of my revenue expectations for Robinhood and also how they came to be. So let's start with Wall Street's expectations, which actually are a lot lower than mine. Wall Street expects a revenue growth rate of 35.2% year over year. As you can see in mine here, I expect 46%. So it's a big discrepancy here. In total, Wall Street expects 921.9 million. I expect almost that 1 billion mark. I expect $997 million of revenue. So there's a quite a big gap, you know, more than 70 million compared to Wall Street. But still, I thought I should take you through how I came to those numbers and also look at some charts, you know, to visualize some of my expectations. So let's start with the biggest segment, which is transaction-based revenues. And as we can see here, it is actually decreasing compared to the prior quarter, but still up 75% year over year, reaching $571 million compared to the previous quarter of $583 million. We'll look at the composition and how I reached that in just a moment. But next up, we have interest revenue, which is the second largest segment. And this one actually have growing quite a lot. So the net interest revenues that I'm expecting year over year is 18% of growth, reaching $336 million. Of revenue compared to 290 in the prior quarter. So that's a big gap up, also a new all-time high. And as I mentioned, we'll get into the details in just a moment. But finally, we have subscription revenues, which you can see a big spike here. And typically you will always see a big spike in Q2 due to the proxy season. So there's a big influx in terms of proxy revenue. So you know, in addition to Robinhood Gold, they also count the proxy revenue within, you know, subscription revenues. So I have that growing 29% year over year, reaching $90 million, a new all-time high. So first, let's break down the transaction-based revenues. The exact amounts here are not important. We will look at that soon. But I want you to focus on the trends here. So the green line here, which I'm tracing with my mouse, I know sometimes you guys complain that, you know, it's hard to tell between the colors, especially some people have color blindness. So I will use my mouse here to demonstrate. So options are kind of carrying this quarter. I have options as the largest contributor this quarter compared to cryptos, which dominated Q1 of 2025. Crypto actually are going down quite a bit compared to the prior quarter, but options and equities are both up. So despite crypto actually going down, it is not based on the take rate, because I have the take rate actually increasing to 0.53%, up from 0.52. So it is merely based on crypto volumes that I'm expecting. And I'll show you exactly how I came to that in just a moment. Next up, we have equities yield going down slightly to 0.013%, which is down from 0.0134%. So, you know, we're in the triple decimals here when we're talking equities yield, which just shows you how mature the equity markets are and how good of a deal you're getting. When you're trading equities on Robinhood, Robinhood does not make a lot of money. Where Robinhood does make a lot of money is crypto, as I mentioned, but also options. However, I still have the options volume yield going down slightly by about 2 percentage points. It was 50% yield compared to the volume in Q1. I have it going down to 48%. And then if we look average revenues per user, I have it increasing slightly compared to the prior quarter, 149. Average revenue per user, up from 145 in Q1, which is still a, you know, a 31% year over year average revenue per user growth, or ARPU, as some people like to say. So the question then is, how did I reach these numbers? So let's start with some data points here. So Robinhood, as you might know, they report monthly data. Let's see if I can remove these ugly lines. There we go. Robinhood reports monthly data, but typically we don't get the final quarter. So we have to make some assumptions here. So I have, first of all, user growth growing to 26 million, which is, you know, quarter over quarter, that's only 1%, but, you know, kind of conservative there. Assets under custody, I have growing to 260 billion, which is, you know, up 18%, but we've had quite drastic growth in assets under custody, just, you know, in May compared to April. So within the quarter, it's already grown a lot. And I think June posted, you know, quite a lot of market profits for people. And I also expected Robinhood to gain a lot of new customers and deposits during the period, which is why I raised it by 5 billion compared to the prior one. Now, the interesting part here is the trading volumes, because, you know, we talked about the take rate, you know, the yield of crypto equities and options. So that's why this becomes interesting. And as I just mentioned, Robinhood does not give us the exact numbers for the final month, which is June here. So what I did is I went to CBOE here, which report trading volume trends. So here we can actually extrapolate. I mean, they have a lot of data for this, but here we can actually look at the monthly data for options and equities. Which is how I came to the conclusion that, you know, in total, there was a lot less, not a lot less, but kind of like 15% decrease in equity trading volume compared to May. So June, about 15% lower. However, options were up compared to May. So that's about how I reached, you know, this estimate here. So it's not that I'm just guessing blindly. I'm looking at the actual trading volumes, and then I'm assigning some percentages based on that and what Robinhood is posting in relation to what they've been doing. For crypto though, CBOE does not report that. However, if we jump here and let me just scroll down in the data sheet. Let's see. I think here, So the way I look at the market share for crypto for Robinhood is, I know that the three largest holdings of crypto on Robinhood are Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Dogecoin. So typically I track it per, I track the volumes of those per quarter. And we actually have Q2 complete data from CoinMarketCap. So it is an 85% decrease compared to the prior quarter. So that's how I came to the number here. I just used 85% compared to Q1 because that's what the volumes indicate. And then I assigned the take rate, which was, as we mentioned in the chart here, the take rate was an assumption that it increased, you know, 0.01% to, you know, 0.53%, up from 0.52% here in the quarter prior. And that's how I got the crypto volume, crypto revenue. And similarly, how I got equities and options is also by assuming a take rate of the total volumes. So that's how I got my transaction-based revenues overall, just by looking at that. So if we look here segmentedly, crypto is the only one going up in take rate, but the volumes were so much lower compared to the prior quarter, about 15% lower. However, options increased in volume, but I decreased the take rate, but it's still such a big gap that they kind of are flattish, a bit up, and also equities are up just based on volumes. So in total, if you're interested in the volumes, my assumption is $512 billion in traded equity volume, 532 million contracts traded, up from 500, and all then for crypto, it is 39 billion, down from 46 billion. So yeah, that's how I reach my trading volumes and the trading revenues. Next up, we have, you know, the interest revenues. So the way I reach that is, let me see here. I made some pretty simple assumptions here. So instead of going into detail, you know, looking at cash sweeps, trying to guess the margin book, trying to guess, you know, cash and deposits and stuff like that, or the credit card, I just took a shortcut and I looked at the total assets under custody. And then I assigned, you know, interest earning assets as a percentage of that. So historically, in recent quarters, in the prior quarter, it was about 21%. I decreased it to 20% interest earning assets as a percentage of assets under custody. But, you know, for some quarters, it has been as high as 30, 27, 24, and a year ago it was actually also 25%. So it is only in recent quarters that it has been going down. So even though assets under custody increased a lot, I actually have the interest earning assets as a percentage of total assets under custody going down slightly to 20.1%, down from 20.7%. And then I assigned, you know, an annual yield based on that. So the prior quarter, it was 2.39%. So I used 2.4%. And that's how I got 314 million in revenue. And then, of course, we have the interest expense to credit facilities that we remove. And then we also have securities lending being added to that. So in total, 336 million. Which results in a 2.57% annual yield compared to the prior quarter of 2.54. So slightly higher yield compared to the previous quarter, which is, I believe, the lowest quarter since Q2 of 2022. So Q1 of 2025 was quite weak in terms of annual yield. I have that going up slightly there. Finally, we have some subscription revenue. See here. Here. So, you know, gold is kind of difficult to guess because the latest gold numbers we got was from the recent gold event. But I have it actually increasing to 45 million in gold subscription revenue, which is up from 38 million the quarter prior. But then the biggest difference here, of course, is the annual, proxy period, which happens in Q2. So historically, it's been around 38 million. So that's what I've used. And then we have other revenues also being pretty consistent here. So I just assume the same, which is 7 million compared to, you know, the two prior quarters, which, you know, in total results in $997 million in net revenue, which is 46% increase. So I hope the video made sense. You know, it kind of gets rough to try to explain numbers and math and how I go about exactly getting the data and making the assumptions, but I thought I should give it a try. You know, it's always easier to just show you guys charts like this, you know, looking at total revenue, transaction revenue. You know, it makes a lot more sense when you look at it like this, but I'm sure there's someone out there that appreciates being shown some of the math on how I reached these different numbers. And with that said, of course, you can go to CoinMarketCap if you want to, you know, collect crypto data, which is what I was told was the most credible source. You know, I'm not a crypto guy, as most of you guys probably know. But I was told that CoinMarketCap is a pretty reliable source in general. So that's where I got my crypto volumes. If you have a better source, which I can, you know, do per coin and per period, let me know. if there is a better one. And also CBOE, if you wanna, you know, track trading volume in the equity markets, especially in the US, also, you know, future contracts, index, stuff like that. And with that said, looking forward to earnings tomorrow. I'm expecting a big beat. And if you wanna prepare yourself and learn about Robinhood, I just posted a big equity research article over on the Substack, research.typefcapital.com. So if you go there, you will find a pretty in-depth article going through everything you need to know about Robinhood. So I really recommend that. I will also be doing a Robinhood earnings review once the earnings are out, you know, show you guys a bunch of charting again. But with that said, thank you so much for watching. Please like and subscribe if you found some value in today's video, and I will see you guys tomorrow. Bye bye.